On December 24, 1944, on a mission over Greece, his aircraft was severely damaged by anti-aircraft fire, and he was ordered to bail out. Upon landing, he was immediately captured by the Germans and then brought to Austria. In Austria, he was helped by an Austrian underground to escape and made his way to Soviet Bulgaria, where he was then turned over to the American forces. Mr. Jones?
Thank you very much. I had started speaking, telling of my experiences during World War II, and I was invited to Guthrie, Texas. And as Joe and I, my wife, walked in, there was a group, I suppose, of seniors over there talking, and I overheard one of them say, "Is that the old geezer that's going to talk to us today?" And I didn't know at that time much about geezers, and it kind of hurt my feelings. So I decided that I would research and find out more of what I actually was, because I have turned out to be an old geezer. But I would like to introduce you to this, and maybe some of you have heard it, I don't know. Geezers are easy to spot. That is slang for an old man. So if you're talking about geezers, that's right. But at sporting events, during the playing of the national anthem, they hold their caps over their hearts and sing without embarrassment. They know the words and believe in them. They remember World War I, the Depression, World War II, Pearl Harbor, Guadalcanal, Normandy, and Hitler. They remember the Atomic Age, the Korean War, the Cold War, the Jet Age, and the Moon Landing, not to mention Vietnam War. The Cold War, all of us certainly remember that. If you bump into a geezer on the sidewalk, he will apologize, pass one on the street, and he'll nod or tip his hat to a lady. Geezers trust strangers and are courtly to women. They hold the door open for the next person and always, when walking, make sure the lady is on the inside of the sidewalk in comparison to the street for protection. Geezers get embarrassed if someone curses in front of a woman or children, and they don't believe in violence and filth on TV and movies. Geezers have moral courage. Geezers seldom brag unless it's about grandchildren's Little League or music recitals. This country needs geezers with their decent values and common sense. We need them now more than ever. It's the geezers who know how great this country is and why it's protected, and not by politicians or police, but by the young men and women of the military serving their country in foreign lands just as they did, without the thought except to do a good job, the best you can, and to get back home to loved ones. Thank God for old geezers. For a few minutes tonight, late this afternoon, would like to talk a little about freedom that we enjoy is not free. You hear it said a lot of times, this is offered to you free, and this is offered to you free. Just remember, young men and young women, that there is no such thing as a free lunch. It had to be paid for. And as you look back into our history, I think all of us can realize that the freedom that we enjoy in America did not come without great cost, monetarily and with human lives. Young men and young women willing to go to war if necessary in order to protect our country and protect the great freedom that you and I enjoy. Not long after World War II was declared, I had just not long before that graduated from school, high school. And me along with thousands, yea, millions of others, in a short period of time, came together as one and realizing that we were in danger. Germany had already been invaded, the different countries. They had already lost their freedom, and we were willing now to go to war, if necessary, in order to protect our great America from the Nazis at that time, and from Japan, of course. Not long after that, I decided to join, as many millions even of young men and women did. And on December the 14th, 1942, I enlisted in the United States Air Corps, no Air Force at that time. And for a few minutes now, I would like to take you on a journey with a young 19-year-old man, never being far out of Lubbock County, never going on a vacation, but living on a farm and working. But I was willing to do that along with 16 million other young men and women that eventually joined and became a part of the force of America. And to show the cost of that, just hurriedly, out of that 16 million, 400,000 lost their lives during World War II. I became a prisoner of war, and after it was tallied up at the end of the war, 190,000 young men and young women were taken as prisoners of war. Even today, there's thousands upon thousands still missing in action that lost their lives and have not been accounted for. And you could give other statistics of the Korean War and the Vietnam War. But you and I are very lucky to live in America that is still free, and we're still trying to help others to have the freedom that we have. On that journey that I'm fixing to take you on, I started out at San Antonio, Texas. There I became a part of the Air Corps, not knowing exactly whether I would be a pilot, a bombardier, navigator, radio operator, whatever. I joined the pilot part, and it wasn't long till it was determined that I did not have the depth perception and the coordination necessary to handle aircraft. And I had the option then of radio in bombers and as a gunner in a bomber. And so I chose that and went to Scottsville, Illinois for radio school and then later to Yuma, Arizona for gunnery school. And then in that journey, before I went overseas, I sent to Tucson, Arizona, where we became a unit of 10 men on a B-24 bomber. And there's where we practiced day by day and night by night of what will happen when we go into combat. Journeys at night, getting lost, all of those things that are necessary. From there, we received orders then that we were fixing to go overseas, and we were sent to Lincoln, Nebraska, and picked up a new B-24, and we were on our way to we didn't know where. Not knowing where we were actually going until we arrived in Casablanca in North Africa. But we left Lincoln, Nebraska. On our first leg, we went to Bangor, Maine. Bangor, Maine to the...
Newfoundland. Newfoundland.
Newfoundland, okay, thank you, Brenda. That's my daughter, she's always happy. I tell people a lot of times, because of my age, I can't reach and find the word I want all the time. And so, if you'll excuse that, we'll get by. And from Gander, Newfoundland, okay, to the Azores Islands, and from the Azores Islands to Casablanca in North Africa. And when we got there, we were told that we would go to Foggia, Italy, and to the air base there, the 485th Bomb Group, 529 Squadron, we'd be a part of that and fly into combat. We arrived there, rested for a few days, and then we began to just fly around in our B-24, acquainting ourselves, and certainly the pilot and the navigator, all observing things in order that when we came in from missions, we had no work to go to land. We flew in the next few days, actually, because they were very short on crews. We flew 22 missions. On our 23rd mission, we were all excited. We realized we were being told that our mission to Greece would be a milk run. Most of you probably know what a milk run is. It's supposed to have been an easy mission. And we left on that mission at 6 o'clock in the morning after being viewed on, reversed on what we would encounter maybe. And we were to hit the target at 12 noon on September the 24th, 1944. We made it to the bomb site where we were supposed to bomb in the railroad yards and in the ports. We just dropped our bombs when the crew in front of us in the group that we went in sevens got a direct hit and just blew up in the air, and a lot of the debris came back and damaged our plane somewhat. And immediately after that, we got a direct hit on our right hand wing and the right hand outside engine and knocked them both off, and we went into a tight spiral. Scared. We was in such a state we didn't know whether we were scared or not, but yes, we were scared. Immediately we got the notice from the pilot, we were in a spiral to bail out. We began to hustle around, make sure that our parachute was on right, that everything was in order, and we had one of our crew members that froze. I'm not bailing out. I said,
could have easily said that because as a young man, I'd go to a swimming pool and I wouldn't dive off the 75 degrees. But I found out at 24,000 feet, I'd have to get out. And so, bailed out. And the young man that froze, was Nephion, a big buddy of mine, myself, finally lasted him around and dropped him out of Bombay. You've never seen a person cry in country at some place when we met each other after landing safe. But we got out of the plane. We would been wrestling with him.
Without oxygen for a few minutes, and we were probably still above 18,000 feet. And I lay awake at night, and I tell my wife, trying to remember how I got out of the plane. But I did. Here I am. I either had to go out to Bombay or jump out the side windows where the machine guns were. But we all got out of the plane. 9 of us were captured. Our pilot wasn't captured. I'd like to say a word about that a little later, because I have a picture here as evidence that he did not go down with the plane. We learned later that he did survive, landed up in the mountains, and the Greeks kept him safe. After he came back in 2 months later, he was looking over the city that we had bombed, and the American troops that were there in Greece then, and found a German newspaper with his crew marching down the streets. Picture that was put in the paper by the Germans, and he recognized in this picture 4 of his crew members. And he took that picture to the War Department. They got our mothers and dads' addresses, and my mother and daddy received this picture about 2 weeks before I actually got home after escaping from the prison camp, and the first time that they knew that I was safe. The telegram that they got was that we were seen going down and no parachutes emerged. We had gone through some clouds that time, and I suppose we bailed out during that time. And the other planes that were on the mission hadn't observed it. So that was very something. And I have a picture. If any of you want to see it, you may after we finish here. We won't take the time now. But the pilot got home, and we learned that he never got captured, got sent home, didn't have to go back to war. And I learned, and our crew learned later, that he died with cancer in 1970. We met in,
South Carolina. South Carolina.
South Carolina. Those of us that were still living and met Cameron, our pilot's
family,
mother, and my partner, mother and
children, not mother.
Children, okay. So that turned out fairly well. But anyhow, after being bailing out, I was taken prisoner immediately. Every one of us that have the same. Germans surrounded us. They ran toward us. The first thing that they got from us was our .45 caliber pistol. We all carried that on every trip that we went on, every mission. And we also, they grabbed me right quick, and one of the Germans took my shoes off of me. And all I had left then was little felt electric shoes that we had to wear at high altitudes. And I had those little felt shoes all the time, the only shoes that I had, until after I got out of the prison camp after escaping. But let's get back to after we were captured. We were taken in one by one, and there we were interrogated. Interrogation didn't last long. Most of you already know, that as a prisoner of war, the only information you're to give is name, rank, and serial number. They'd ask me a question, and I'd say, Homer Jones, Sergeant, 1819-6776. And the German interrogator would just go to another question. They knew more of what was happening than I did. So if I'd given them something, they probably already knew it anyhow. But anyhow, after interrogation, they took us out and marched us down the street of the city that we just bombed. And this is when this picture was taken. After this, we were put into solitary confinement for 3 days. And I tell young men that are ashamed of crying that that's where I learned to cry. I began to think of my family, what my mother looked like, what happened to me, how long I would be there. All of my freedom was taken away. That was a great cost to me. But anyhow, after 3 days, they took us out of solitary confinement and had train, flat cars, ready to leave. They had gotten an engine or two and had repaired the tracks and so forth. And we were ready, we were told, for them to take us to Germany. But we, in the next 20 to 30, I could give the dates on some of these, and I have them here, but I can't recall all of them. In about 30 days, we finally reached, after being shot up by American planes, Czechoslovakian planes, we finally got to Austria, where we were put in a camp with captured Russians. There was a little stockade that was attached to that had 56 Americans and British. So we weren't a part of the Russians. They had paid very little attention to us. Went along that people began to come and visit, knowing that we had some other Americans there. And during that visit, we found out that there was an underworld group that would help us if we were able to escape. I'll stop here and just make this statement. You young men and young women, there's two things that I learned in situations that I was in. That there's two things that you want to try to stay away from, and that is homesickness and hunger. They'll make you think a lot of things maybe that otherwise wouldn't be feasible. And we sat around and picked lice off our bodies and talked about this and that. And after talking to these underground people, they told us if we were able to escape, that they would provide for us the best they could and get us out of Austria into Yugoslavia with Marshal Tito and his group. Well, on a bad snowstorm on December the 27th, it's 2 days before Christmas, Wilson F. Leon and I decided we would try to escape. Knowing, after sitting up at nights observing, that never a guard around, only a guard dog or two. And so about 2 o'clock in the morning, we took our old straw, louse-infected mattresses, threw them over the 8-foot fence. It had some entanglements at the top, but not bad. And we were able to pull ourselves up and go over. And we knew where to go. I had on my little felt shoes, all I had. And by the time I got there and observed later, I had frozen my toenails, especially the extremities of my feet. And my wife told me if she had looked at my feet before we married, she might never have married. This is my wife sitting here. Joe, stand up. If we continue to live together until June the 1st of next year, 18, we will have been married 72 years. But anyhow, we escaped and we got to the place after running, and we carried one of the guard dogs with us. We had made friends with the yard with the guard dog. And we got to this place, and we woke them up, very easy to wake up. They hid us immediately in some places they had in their home. Warmed us up, began to make arrangements to get us some other clothes, get me some shoes, and made contact with Marshal Tito and his group, and we were ready to get out of there and get on our way. We got to Marshal Tito's group, and he told us the best thing to do is to get out of Yugoslavia because Yugoslavia was still infested with Germans. He says, get on over into the Baltics, into Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria, that all the Germans, most all of them, are out of those countries. Well, we got out and started on our way. Went first to Hungary, out of Yugoslavia, into Hungary. From Hungary to Bulgaria, and then from Bulgaria to Romania, then to Bulgaria, and we ended up with the capital of Bulgaria, Sofia, Bulgaria, and had an American mission there, a small number of Americans there. There we began to make arrangements to get out of there and get back to our base in Italy. But it was not until in April sometime that we did that. They finally flew an old C-47, if you know what that is, one of the rough tumble aircraft of World War II, did many, many missions everywhere. They came, flew one in there, and flew us back to our base in Italy. They loused us, gave us some new clothes, bathed us good, and we were ready to get out of there then, and they took us to Rome, Italy. We boarded USS West Point, a large troop ship, and headed toward America. And about 12 days later, we landed in New York Harbor. I received instructions, orders, to go to San Antonio, Texas. I got there, they immediately gave me a 30-day furlough, and I went to see my folks at Slayton, Texas. After the 30-day furlough, I had to report to Miami, Florida, there to be examined, to see what fits, if I was fit to continue being in the Air Corps. And they found out, I guess, that I wasn't, and sent me to St. Petersburg, Florida for rehab. I was there a little over 2 months, and when they finished with me, they asked me where I wanted to go. And I said, Lubbock Army Air Base. That's just 16 miles from Slayton. They wrote orders, I went there, stayed there without actually an assignment, but just being there to sign the payroll and go get paid. And on November the 6th, 1945, I was discharged in Roswell, New Mexico. Went home on June the 1st, or January the 1st of 1946, I entered Tech. On June the 1st of 1946, I married Joe. We had 5 children. I graduated from Tech in 1948 with my bachelor's, not until 1959 with my master's. I taught vocational agriculture in one school for 35 years. Retired in 1983. During that period of time, 37 years I believe now, I preached for the small congregations of the Church of Christ in the area around Wellman and Slayton and Lubbock. We moved to Lubbock in 2000. We now live in a residential place, actually assisted living place, Wilshire place, here in Lubbock. And by the grace of God, I'm still able at nearly 95 to tell my story. And I always close with this as my closing prayer. If you would humbly bow with me. God, bless America, land that we love. Stand beside her and guide her with the lights from above. From the mountains to the prairies, to the oceans white with foam. God bless America.